This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. A lock is a device used for raising and lowering boats, ships and other watercraft between stretches of water of different levels on river and canal waterways. The distinguishing feature of a lock is a fixed chamber in which the water level can be varied, whereas in a caisson lock, a boat lift, or on a canal inclined plane, it is the chamber itself, usually then called a caisson, that rises and falls. Locks are used to make a river more easily navigable, or to allow a canal to take a reasonably direct line across land that is not level. Since 2016, the largest lock worldwide is the Kieldrecht lock in the port of Antwerp, Belgium. Contents 1 pound lock, 2 use in river navigation, 3 use in canals, 4 basic construction and operation, 5 details and terminology, 51 rise, 52 pound, 53 chamber, 54 sill, 55 gates, 56 balance beam, 57 paddle, 58 winding gear or paddle gear, 59 hydraulic paddle gear, 510 windlass lock key, 511 turning a lock, 512 swell or swelling, 513 lock mooring, 514 snubbing posts, 6 variations, 7 special cases, 71 lock flights, 72 staircase locks, 73 doubled, paired or twinned locks, 74 stop locks, 75 round locks, 76 drop locks, 77 flood locks, 78 flood gates, 79 bi-directional gates and locks, 710 tidal locks, 711 inlet locks, 712 very large locks, 7121 Hiram M. Chittenden locks, 8 history and development, 81 dams and weirs, 82 flash locks, 83 staunch, 84 pound lock, 85 turf sided lock, 9 use of water, 91 design, 92 pumping, 93 water saving basins, 10 alternatives, 101 inclined plane, 1011 marine railway, 102 boat lift, 103 caisson lock, 104 hydro pneumatic canal lift, 105 shaft lock, 106 diagonal lock, 107 a combined system, the Three Gorges Dam, 11 ship sizes named after locks, 12 see also, 13 references, 14 external links. Pound lock, a pound lock on the Kaitele Pijane Canal at Onikoski in central Finland. A pound lock is a type of lock that is used almost exclusively nowadays on canals and rivers. A pound lock has a chamber with gates at both ends that control the level of water in the pound. In contrast, an earlier design with a single gate was known as a flash lock. Pound locks were first used in medieval China during the Song Dynasty 960-1279 AD, having been pioneered by the government official and engineer Chao Weiyui in 984. They replaced earlier double slipways that had caused trouble and are mentioned by the Chinese polymath Shen Kuo 1031-1095 in his book Dream Pool Essays, published in 1088, and fully described in the Chinese historical text Song Shi, compiled in 1345. The distance between the two locks was rather more than 50 paces, and the whole space was covered with a great roof like a shed. The gates were hanging gates. When they were closed, the water accumulated like a tide until the required level was reached, and then when the time came it was allowed to flow out. The water level could differ by 4 feet 12. Locks on the Rideau Canal, Entrance Valley, near Parliament Hill, Ottawa, Canada. When a stretch of river is made navigable, a lock is sometimes required to bypass an obstruction such as a rapid, dam, or mill weir, because of the change in river level across the obstacle. In large-scale river navigation improvements, weirs and locks are used together. A weir will increase the depth of a shallow stretch, and the required lock will either be built in a gap in the weir, or at the downstream end of an artificial cut which bypasses the weir and perhaps a shallow stretch of river below it. A river improved by these means is often called a waterway or river navigation. See example Calder and Hebel navigation. Sometimes a river is made entirely non-tidal by constructing a sea lock directly into the estuary. In more advanced river navigations, more locks are required where a longer cut bypasses a circuitous stretch of river. The upstream end of the cut will often be protected by a flood lock. The longer the cut, the greater the difference in river level between start and end of the cut, so that a very long cut will need additional locks along its length. At this point, the cut is, in effect, a canal use in canals. Locks of the Panama Canal during construction, 1913. Early completely artificial canals, across fairly flat countryside, would get round a small hill or depression by simply detouring, contouring around it. As engineers became more ambitious in the types of country they felt they could overcome, locks became essential to effect the necessary changes in water level without detours that would be completely uneconomic both in building costs and journey time. Later still, as construction techniques improved, engineers became more willing to cut directly through through and across obstacles by constructing long tunnels, cuttings, aqueducts or embankments, or to construct even more technical devices such as inclined planes or boat lifts. However, locks continued to be built to supplement these solutions, and are an essential part of even the most modern navigable waterways. Basic construction and operation: a plan and side view of a generic, empty canal lock. A lock chamber separated from the rest of the canal by an upper pair and a lower pair of mitre gates. The gates in each pair close against each other at an 18 degrees angle to approximate an arch against the water pressure on the upstream side of the gates when the water level on the downstream side is lower. Principle of operation of a pound lock for a boat going upstream, for a boat going downstream. 1-2 the boat enters the lock. 8-9 the boat enters the lock. 3 the lower gates are closed. 10 the upper gates are closed. 4-5 the lock is filled with water from upstream. 11-12 the lock is emptied by draining its water downstream. 6 the upper gates are opened. 13 the lower gates are opened. 7 the boat exits the lock. 14 the boat exits the lock. All pound locks have three elements: a watertight chamber connecting the upper and lower canals, and large enough to enclose one or more boats. The position of the chamber is fixed, but its water level can vary. A gate, often a pair of pointing half gates at each end of the chamber. A gate is opened to allow a boat to enter or leave the chamber. When closed, the gate is watertight. A set of lock gear to empty or fill the chamber is required. This is usually a simple valve. Traditionally, a flat panel paddle lifted by manually winding a rack and pinion mechanism which allows water to drain into or out of the chamber. Larger locks may use pumps. The principle of operating a lock is simple. For instance, if a boat traveling downstream finds the lock already full of water, the entrance gates are opened and the boat moves in. The entrance gates are closed. A valve is opened. This lowers the boat by draining water from the chamber. The exit gates are opened and the boat moves out. If the lock were empty, the boat would have had to wait 5 to 10 minutes while the lock was filled. For a boat traveling upstream, the process is reversed. The boat enters the empty lock. And then the chamber is filled by opening a valve that allows water to enter the chamber from the upper level. The whole operation will usually take between 10 and 20 minutes, depending on the size of the lock and whether the water in the lock was originally set at the boat's level. Boaters approaching a lock are usually pleased to meet another boat coming towards them, because this boat will have just exited the lock on their level and therefore set the lock in their favor, saving about 5 to 10 minutes. However, this is not true for staircase locks, where it is quicker for boats to go through in convoy. Operation of a canal lock. 1-3 boat enters empty lock. 4 bottom gates are closed, bottom paddles closed, top paddles opened, lock starts to fill. 5 lock is filling with water, lifting boat to the higher level. Details and terminology: an empty lock chamber. For simplicity, this section describes a basic type of lock, with a pair of gates at each end of the chamber and simple rack and pinion paddles raised manually by means of a detachable windlass operated by lock keepers or the boat's shore crew. This type can be found all over the world, but the terminology here is that used on the British canals. A subsequent section explains common variations. Rise: the rise is the change in water level in the lock. The two deepest locks on the English canal system are Bath Deep Lock on the Kennet and Avon Canal and Tool Lane Lock on the Rochdale Canal, which both have a rise of nearly 20 feet 61. A pound is the level stretch of water between two locks, also known as a reach on American canals. A pound is called a level chamber. The chamber is the main feature of a lock. It is a watertight masonry, brick, steel or concrete enclosure which can be sealed off from the pounds at both ends by means of gates. The chamber may be the same size plus a little maneuvering room as the largest vessel for which the waterway was designed, sometimes larger, to allow more than one such vessel at a time to use the lock. The chamber is said to be full when the water level is the same as in the upper pound, and empty when the level is the same as in the lower pound if the lock has no water in it at all, perhaps for maintenance work. It might also be said to be empty, but it is more usually described as drained or dewatered. Sill: the sill exposed in the deep Pont de Flandre lock on the Canal Saint-Denis, Paris. Top gate of a lock, showing the balance beams and paddle winding gear. 200-year-old paddle gear on the Wiener Neustadter Canal, Austria. Water conservation gear on the Birmingham Canal navigations. The sill, also spelled sill, is a narrow horizontal ledge protruding a short way into the chamber from below the upper gates, allowing the rear of the boat to hang on the sill as the main danger. One is warned to guard against when descending a lock, and the position of the forward edge of the sill is usually marked on the lock side by a white line. The edge of the sill is usually curved, protruding less in the center than at the edges. In some locks, there is a piece of oak about 9 upper pound, while the lower gate has to be able to seal off a full chamber. The upper gate is as tall as the canal is deep, plus a little more for the balance beam, winding mechanism, etc. The lower gate's height equals the upper gate plus the lock's rise balance beam. A balance beam is the long arm projecting from the landward side of the gate over the towpath, as well as providing leverage to open and close the heavy gate. The beam also balances the non-floating weight of the gate in its socket, and so allows the gate to swing more freely. Paddle. A paddle, sometimes known as a slacker, clough, or in American English wicket, is the simple valve by which the lock chamber is filled or emptied. The paddle itself is a sliding wooden or nowadays plastic panel which, when lifted, slid up out of the way, allows water to either enter the chamber from the upper pound or flow out to the lower pound. A gate paddle simply covers a hole in the lower part of a gate. A more sophisticated ground paddle blocks an underground culvert. There can be up to 8 paddles, 2 gate paddles and 2 ground paddles at both upper and lower ends of the chamber, but there will often be fewer for a long period. Since the 1970s, it was British Waterways policy not to provide gate paddles in replacement top gates. If 2 ground paddles existed, the reason for this was given as safety, since it is possible for an ascending boat to be swamped by the water from a carelessly lifted gate paddle. However, without the gate paddles, the locks are slower to operate, and this has been blamed in some places for causing congestion. Since the late 1990s, the preferred method has been to retain or reinstall the gate paddles and fit baffles across them to minimize the risk of inundation on the old Erie Canal. There was a danger of injury when operating the paddles. Water, on reaching a certain position, would push the paddles with a force which could tear the windlass or handle out of one's hands, or if one was standing in the wrong place, could knock one into the canal, leading to injuries and drownings. Winding gear or paddle gear. Winding gear is the mechanism which allows paddles to be lifted, opened or lowered, closed. Typically, a square section stub emerges from the housing of the winding gear. This is the axle of a sprocket pinion, which engages with a toothed bar rack attached by rodding to the top of the paddle. A lock keeper or member of the boat's shore crew engages the square socket of their windlass, see below, onto the end of the axle and turns the windlass perhaps a dozen times. This rotates the pinion and lifts the paddle. A pawl engages with the rack to prevent the paddle from dropping inadvertently while being raised, and to keep it raised when the windlass is removed, so that the operator can attend to other paddles. Nowadays, it is considered discourteous and wasteful of water to leave a paddle open after a boat has left the lock, but in commercial days it was normal practice to lower a paddle. The pawl must be disengaged and the paddle wound down with the windlass dropping. Paddles by knocking the pawl off can cause damage to the mechanism. The paddle gear is typically made of cast iron and can shatter or crack when dropped from a height in areas where water wastage due to vandalism is a problem. For example, the Birmingham Canal Navigations paddle mechanisms are commonly fitted with vandal-proof locks. Nowadays, rebranded water conservation devices, which require the boater to employ a key before the paddle can be lifted. The keys are officially known as water conservation keys, but boaters usually refer to them as T-keys, from their shape, handcuff keys, because the original locks, fitted on the Leeds and Liverpool Canal, resembled handcuffs, Leeds and Liverpool keys after that canal, or simply anti-vandal keys. Hydraulic paddle gear. During the 1980s, British Waterways began to introduce a hydraulic system for operating paddles, especially those on bottom gates, which are the heaviest to operate. A metal cylinder about a foot in diameter was mounted on the balance beam and contained a small oil-operated hydraulic pump. A spindle protruded from the front face and was operated by a windlass in the usual way, the energy being transferred to the actual paddle by small bore pipes. The system was widely installed, and on some canals it became very common. There turned out to be two serious drawbacks. It was much more expensive to install and maintain than traditional gear and went wrong more frequently, especially once vandals learned to cut the pipes. Even worse, it had a safety defect, in that the paddle, once in the raised position, could not be dropped in an emergency, but had to be wound down, taking a good deal longer. These factors led to the abandonment of the policy in the late 1990s, but examples of it survive all over the system, as it is usually not removed until the gates need replacing, which happens about every 20 years. Windlass lock key. Collection of lock windlasses. Note, rakes are for clearing trash out of the lock. A windlass, also variously lock handle, iron, or simply key, is a detachable crank used for opening lock paddles. The word does not refer to the winding mechanism itself. The simplest windlass is made from an iron rod of circular section, about half an inch in diameter and 2 feet long, bent to make an L shape with legs of slightly different length. The shorter leg is called the handle, and the longer leg is called the arm. Welded to the end of the arm is a square, sometimes tapered, socket of the correct size to fit onto the spindle protruding from lock winding gear socket. Traditionally, windlasses had a single socket, designed for a particular canal when undertaking a journey through several canals with different lock gear spindle sizes. It was necessary to carry several different windlasses. A modern windlass usually has two sockets for use on different canals. The smaller is for the British Waterways standard spindle, fitted in the early 1990s almost everywhere, the larger for the gear on the Grand Union Canal north of Napton Junction, which they were unwilling to convert handle. The handle is long enough for a two-handed grip and is far enough from the socket to give enough leverage to wind the paddle up or down. There may be a freely rotating sleeve around the handle to protect the hands from the friction of rough iron against skin arm. A long throw windlass has a longer arm so that the handle is further from the socket to give a greater leverage on stiffer paddles. If the throw is too long, then the user winding a gate paddle risks barking their knuckles against the balance beam when the handle is at the lowest point of its arc. A sophisticated modern windlass may have an adjustable length arm materials. The Dunton Double, has only a single eye, but by clever tapering it will operate either size of spindle on the Chesapeake and Ohio Canal. The lockkeepers were required to remove the windlasses from all lock paddles at night, to prevent unauthorized use. Turning a lock can simply mean emptying a full lock, or filling an empty one. We entered the lock, and it only took us 5 minutes to turn it. It is used more often to refer to a lock being filled or emptied for the benefit of someone else. The lock was turned for us by a boat coming the other way, and sometimes the opposite. The lock was set for us, but the crew of the boat coming the other way turned it before we got there. Swell or swelling. A swell was caused by opening suddenly the paddle valves in the lock gates, or when emptying a lock to help boats leave downstream a lock. The locksman would sometimes open the paddles to create a swell, which would help flush the boat out of the lock. In one case, a boatsman asked for a back swell, that is, open and shut the paddles a few times to create some waves, to help him get off the bank where he was stuck if boats ran aground from being overloaded. They sometimes asked passing crews to tell the upstream lock to give them an extra heavy swell, which consisted of opening all the paddles on the lock gate, creating a surge that affected the whole pound below on the Erie Canal. Some loaded boats needed a swell to get out of the lock, particularly lumber boats, being top-heavy, would list to one side and get stuck in the lock, and needed a swell to get them out. Some lockkeepers would give a swell to anyone to help them on the way, but some would ask for money for the swell. The Erie Canal management did not like swelling, since it one used too much water, lowering the water on the pound above sometimes causing boats to run aground, two it raised the water level on the pound below causing some boats to strike bridges or get stuck. Lock mooring was a commonly used method of navigating into a lock by a barge traveling upstream. The barge would be directed to the slack water to one side of the lock gates, and as the volume of water decreased as the lock emptied, the barge or boat is effectively sucked out of the slack water into the path of the lock gates. The effort required to navigate the barge or boat into the mouth of the lock was therefore substantially reduced. Snubbing post, snubbing a boat to keep it from hitting the downstream gates. Note the rope wrapped around the snubbing post on horse-drawn and mule-drawn canals. Snubbing posts were used to slow or stop a boat in the lock. A 200-ton boat moving at a few miles an hour could destroy the lock gate. To prevent this, a rope was wound around the snubbing post as the boat entered the lock. Pulling on the rope slowed the boat, due to the friction of the rope against the post. A rope 2.5 inches 63. On most English narrow canals, the upper end of the chamber is closed by a single gate the full width of the lock. This was cheaper to construct and is quicker to operate with a small crew, as only one gate needs to be opened. These were often fitted with a post allowing a rope to be used to stop the boat and close the gate at the same time. Some narrow locks, e.g. on Birmingham Canal navigations, go even further. They have single gates at the lower end. Also, this speeds up passage, even though single lower gates are heavier than a single upper gate, because the lower gate is taller and the lock has to be longer. A lower gate opens into the lock, it has to pass the bow or stern of an enclosed boat, and a single gate has a wider arc than two half gates. A few narrow locks imitate wide locks in having paired gates at both ends. An example is the Bosley Lock Flight on the Macclesfield Canal. Steel gates and or balance beams are frequently used nowadays, although all wooden versions are still fitted where appropriate. Swinging gates, even very large steel gated locks still can use essentially the same swinging gate design as small 250-year-old locks on the English canals. On English canals, steel gates usually have wooden mitre posts, as this gives a better seal. Sliding gates, some low headlocks use sliding steel gates. See Kiel Canal. The sliding gates of the New Meersluis in Amsterdam double as roadways. Kaisen gates, a kind of sliding gate that is hollow and can float. It can be constructed to withstand high heads guillotine gates. Some locks have vertically moving steel gates. These are quite common on river navigations in East Anglia. Sometimes just one of the pairs of swinging gates is replaced by a guillotine, for instance at Salterhebel locks, where space to swing the balance beams of bottom gates of the lowest lock was restricted by bridge widening on the River Nene. Most locks have this arrangement, as in time of flood the top mitre gates are chained open and the bottom guillotines lift so that the lock chamber acts as an overflow sluice. Guillotine gates are also used on the downstream side of larger locks, such as the 23 meters Boleyn lock on the River Rhone, the aperture being large enough for a boat to travel under it. Vertically rotating gates, American usage. Drop gates, example of a lock with a drop gate. Lock 10 on the Chesapeake and Ohio Canal are gates which, when open, lie flat on the canal bed and which close by lifting London flood barrier. Some of these were installed on the Chesapeake and Ohio Canal in the congested Seven Locks area, since they could be operated by one man and also could speed up traffic. Rotating sector gates, some of these work very like traditional swinging gates, but with each gate in the form of a sector of a cylinder. They close by rotating out from the lock wall and meeting in the center of the chamber. Water is let in or out by opening the gates slightly. There are no paddles or other lock gear. The lock at Limehouse Basin, which gives access to the River Thames, is an example. A dramatically large one can be seen at the Maeslankering huge flood gates near Rotterdam. There is a different type at the sea lock on the Ribble Link. This is a rising sector gate, which has a horizontal axis. The gate drops to the bed of the river to allow boats to pass. Different paddle gear. Some manually operated paddles do not require a detachable handle windlass because they have their handles ready attached on the Leeds and Liverpool Canal. There is a variety of different lock gear. Some paddles are raised by turning what is in effect a large horizontal wing nut, butterfly nut, lifting a screw-threaded bar attached to the top of the paddle. Others are operated by lifting a long wooden lever, which operates a wooden plate which seals the culvert. These are known locally as jack cluffs. Bottom gate paddles are sometimes operated by a horizontal ratchet which also slides a wooden plate sideways, rather than the more common vertical lift. Many of these idiosyncratic paddles have been modernized, and they are becoming rare on the Calder and Hebel navigation. Some paddle gear is operated by repeatedly inserting a Calder and Hebel handspike length of 4x2 hardwood into a ground level slotted wheel and pushing down on the handspike to rotate the wheel on its horizontal axis. On some parts of the Montgomery Canal, bottom paddles are used in place of side paddles rather than passing into the lock through a culvert around the side of the lock gate. The water flows through a culvert in the bottom of the canal. The paddle slides horizontally over the culvert. Composite locks to economize, especially where good stone would be prohibitively expensive or difficult to obtain. Composite locks were made, i.e. they were constructed using rubble or inferior stone, dressing the inside walls of the lock with wood, so as not to abrade the boats. This was done, for instance, on the Chesapeake and Ohio Canal with the locks near the Paw Paw Tunnel and also the Shenango Canal, because the wood would swell, making the lock space smaller or rot away. The wood was often replaced by concrete. Lock keepers, main article. Lock keeper, some locks are operated or at least supervised by professional or volunteer lock keepers. This is particularly true on commercial waterways, or where locks are large or have complicated features that the average leisure boater may not be able to operate successfully. For instance, although the Thames above Teddington, England, is almost entirely a leisure waterway, the locks are usually staffed. Only recently have boaters been allowed limited access to the hydraulic gear to operate the locks when the keeper is not present. Powered operation on large modern canals, especially very large ones such as ship canals, the gates and paddles are too large to be hand-operated, and are operated by hydraulic or electrical equipment. Even on smaller canals, some gates and paddles are electrically operated, particularly if the lock is regularly staffed by professional lock keepers. On the River Thames below Oxford, all the locks are staffed and powered. Powered locks are usually still filled by gravity, though some very large locks use pumps to speed things up. Fish ladders, the construction of locks or weirs and dams on rivers obstructs the passage of fish. Some fish such as trout and salmon go upstream to spawn. Measures such as a fish ladder are often taken to counteract this. Way lock, a way lock on the Lehigh Canal. A way lock is a specialized canal lock designed to determine the weight of barges to assess toll payments based upon the weight and value of the cargo carried. The Erie Canal had a way locks in Rochester, Syracuse, and West Troy, New York. The Lehigh Canal also had way locks. See photo on right. Special cases. Lock flights. The flight of 16 locks at Conn Hill on the Kennet and Avon Canal. Loosely, a flight of locks is simply a series of locks in close enough proximity to be identified as a single group for many reasons. A flight of locks is preferable to the same number of locks spread more widely. Crews are put ashore and picked up once, rather than multiple times. Transition involves a concentrated burst of effort, rather than a continually interrupted journey. A lock keeper may be stationed to help crews through the flight quickly, and where water is in short supply, a single pump can recycle water to the top of the whole flight. The need for a flight may be determined purely by the lie of the land, but it is possible to group locks purposely into flights by using cuttings or embankments to postpone the height change. Examples: Con Hill locks, devises flight is not synonymous with staircase. See below. A set of locks is only a staircase if successive lock chambers share a gate, i.e. do not have separate top and bottom gates with a pound between them. Most flights are not staircases, because each chamber is a separate lock with its own upper and lower gates. There is a navigable pound, however short, between each pair of locks, and the locks are operated in the conventional way. However, some flights include or consist entirely of staircases on the Grand Union Leicester Canal. The Watford flight consists of a four-chamber staircase and three separate locks, and the Foxton flight consists entirely of two adjacent five-chamber staircases. Staircase locks. Staircase of five locks, dating from 1774, at Bingley, England, where a very steep gradient has to be climbed, a lock staircase is used. There are two types of staircase, real and apparent. A real staircase can be thought of as a compressed flight, where the intermediate pounds have disappeared, and the upper gate of one lock is also the lower gate of the one above it. However, it is incorrect to use the terms staircase and flight interchangeably, because of the absence of intermediate pounds. Operating a staircase is very different from operating a flight. It can be more useful to think of a staircase as a single lock with intermediate levels. The top gate is a normal top gate, and the intermediate gates are all as tall as the bottom gate, as there is no intermediate pound. A chamber can only be filled by emptying the one above, or emptied by filling the one below. Thus the whole staircase has to be full of water except for the bottom chamber before a boat starts to ascend, or empty except for the top chamber before a boat starts to descend. By building a pair of such lock sets, one used to climb and the other to descend, these difficulties are avoided, as well as enabling a greater traffic volume and reduced wait times. In an apparent staircase, the chambers still have common gates, but the water does not pass directly from one chamber to the next, going instead via side ponds. This means it is not necessary to ensure that the flight is full or empty before starting. Examples of famous real staircases in England are Bingley and Grindley Brook. Two rise staircases are more common. Snakeholm Lock and Struncheon Hill Lock on the Driffield Navigation were converted to staircase locks after low water levels hindered navigation over the bottom sill at all but the higher tides. The new bottom chamber rises just far enough to get the boat over the original lock sill. In China, the recently completed Three Gorges Dam includes a double five-step staircase for large ships, and a ship lift for vessels of less than 3,000 metric tons. Examples of apparent staircases are Foxton locks and Watford locks on the Leicester branch of the Grand Union. Instructions for descent of treble staircase. Chesterfield Canal. Operation of a staircase is more involved than a flight. Inexperienced boaters may find operating staircase locks difficult. The key worries, apart from simply being paralyzed with indecision, are either sending down more water than the lower chambers can cope with, flooding the towpath, or sending a tidal wave along the canal, or completely emptying an intermediate chamber. Although this shows that a staircase lock can be used as an emergency dry dock to avoid these mishaps, it is usual to have the whole staircase empty before starting to descend, or full before starting to ascend. Apart from the initial chamber, one striking difference in using a staircase of either type compared with a single lock or a flight is the best sequence for letting boats through in a single lock or a flight with room. For boats to pass, boats should ideally alternate in direction in a staircase. However, it is quicker for a boat to follow a previous one going in the same direction. Partly for this reason, staircase locks such as Grindley Brook, Foxton, Watford and Bratch are supervised by lockkeepers, at least during the main cruising season. They normally try to alternate as many boats up, followed by down, as there are chambers in the flight as with a flight. It is possible on a broad canal for more than one boat to be in a staircase at the same time, but managing this without waste of water requires expertise on English canals. A staircase of more than two chambers is usually staffed. The lockkeepers at Bingley, looking after both the five rise and the three rise, ensure that there are no untoward events and that boats are moved through as speedily and efficiently as possible. Such expertise permits miracles of boat balletics. Boats traveling in opposite directions can pass each other halfway up the staircase by moving sideways around each other, or at peak times, one can have all the chambers full simultaneously with boats traveling in the same direction doubled. paired or twinned locks, doubled locks. Left lock has boat in it, right lock center of drawing is empty. This is on the Erie Canal at Lockport. Locks can be built side by side on the same waterway. This is variously called doubling, pairing, or twinning. The Panama Canal has three sets of double locks. Doubling gives advantages in speed, avoiding hold-ups at busy times and increasing the chance of a boat finding a lock set in its favor. There can also be water savings. The locks may be of different sizes, so that a small boat does not need to empty a large lock, or each lock may be able to act as a side pond water-saving basin for the other. In this latter case, the word used is usually twinned, here indicating the possibility of saving water by synchronizing the operation of the chambers so that some water from the emptying chamber helps to fill the other. This facility has long been withdrawn on the English canals, although the disused paddle gear can sometimes be seen, as at Hillmorton on the Oxford Canal. Elsewhere they are still in use. A pair of twinned locks has been opened in 2014 on the Dortmund Ems Canal near Munster, Germany. The once famous staircase at Lockport, New York was also a doubled set of locks. Five twinned locks allowed east and west bound boats to climb or descend the 60 feet 18. Twin lock is often used by novices on the English canals to mean a wide 14. Because it was to stop water flowing continuously between the newer canal and the older, lower one. The lock would be under the control of the new company, and the gates would, of course, point uphill towards the newer canal. This would protect the water supply of the newer canal, but would nevertheless donate a lockful of water to the older company every time a boat went through. In times of excess water, of course, the lock bywash would continuously supply water to the lower canal when variable conditions meant that a higher water level in the new canal could not be guaranteed. Then the older company would also build a stop lock under its own control, with gates pointing towards its own canal, which could be closed when the new canal was low. This resulted in a sequential pair of locks, with gates pointing in opposite directions. One example was at Hall Green near Kidsgrove, where the southern terminus of the Macclesfield Canal joined the Hall Green branch of the earlier Trent and Mersey Canal. The four-gate stop lock near King's Norton Junction, between the Stratford-upon-Avon Canal and the Worcester and Birmingham Canal, was replaced in 1914 by a pair of guillotine lock gates, which stopped the water flow regardless of which canal was higher. These gates have been permanently open since nationalization. Many stop locks were removed or converted to a single gate after nationalization in 1948. Hall Green stop lock remains, but as a single lock. The extra lock was removed because the lowering of the T height above the water level meant that the T France. This serves as a lock on the main line of the canal and allows access to the Arrow River. A second French round lock can be found in the form of the, now disused, Écluse des Lorraines, connecting the canal lateral à la Loire with the river. Allier drop locks. Dalmier drop lock. A drop lock allows a short length of canal to be lowered temporarily while a boat passes under an obstruction such as a low bridge during canal restoration. A drop lock may be used where it is impractical or prohibitively expensive to remove or raise a structure that was built after the canal was closed and where rerouting the canal is not possible. A drop lock can consist of two conventional lock chambers leading to a sump pound, or a single long chamber incorporating the sump, although the term properly applies only to the second case, as the pounds at either end of the structure are at the same height. The lock can only be emptied either by allowing water to run to waste from the sump to a lower stream or drain, or less wastefully by pumping water back up to the canal. Particularly in the two-chamber type, there would be a need for a bypass culvert to allow water to move along the interrupted pound and so supply locks further down the canal. In the case of the single chamber type, this can be achieved by keeping the lock full and leaving the gates open while not in use. While the concept has been suggested in a number of cases, the only example in the world of a drop lock that has actually been constructed is at Dalmier on the Forth and Clyde Canal in Scotland. This lock, of the single chamber type, was incorporated during the restoration of the canal, to allow the replacement of a swing bridge on a busy road by a fixed bridge, and so answer criticisms that the restoration of the canal would cause frequent interruptions of the heavy road traffic. It can be emptied by pumping, but as this uses a lot of electricity, the method used when water supplies are adequate as to drain the lock to a nearby burn. A series of pictures showing the operation of the lock can be seen here. Flood locks. A flood lock is to prevent a river from flooding a connected waterway. It is typically installed where a canal leaves a river at normal river levels. The lock gates are left open, and the height of the canal is allowed to rise and fall with the height of the river. However, if the river floods beyond a safe limit for the canal, then the gates are closed and an extra lock created until the river drops again. Since this is a true lock, it is possible for boats to leave the canal for the flooded river despite the difference in water levels, though this is not likely to be wise or more sensibly to allow boats caught out on the flood to gain refuge in the canal. Note that if the canal is simply a navigation cut connecting two stretches of the same river, the flood lock will be at the upstream end of the cut. The downstream end will have a conventional lock. Flood locks, which have been used only as flood gates see below, are often incapable of reverting to their former purpose without refurbishment, that is, where only outer gates are ever closed, probably because a waterway is not a true commercial one, and therefore there is no financial imperative for a boat to venture out onto a flooded river. Inner gates soon suffer from lack of maintenance. A good example is on the Calder and Hebel navigation, where structures referred to in the boating guides as flood locks are clearly only capable of being used for flood prevention, not for penning boats to or from the river in flood. Flood gates. Main article: flood gate. Bi-directional flood gates on the canal. Schouten Dessel, Belgium. Flood gate or stop gate. American usage on Chesapeake and Ohio Canal. When a flood threatened, boards were put in the lock to divert waters from the canal prism to the Potomac River. Note: winch house on top for the boards. A flood gate or stop gate is the cheaper equivalent of a flood lock. Only one set of gates exist, and so when the river is higher than the canal, the gates are closed and navigation ceases. These are quite common in the French inland waterways system. Flood gates may also be used to sub-divide long canal pounds or protect, in case of bank collapse, the surrounding area if this is lower than the water level of the canal. They are commonly found at the ends of long embankments and at aqueducts. These gates are often overlooked because they lack balance beams and are only a little higher than normal canal level. Bi-directional gates and locks. Bi-directional gates at one chamber end of a tidal lock located in Verne on the canal. Newport, Dunkirk, where a lock is tidal, i.e. one side of the lock has water whose level varies with the tide, or where a canal meets a river whose level may vary, the water on the tidal or river side, the downstream side, may rise above the water on the normal upper side. The upstream pointing doors will then fail to do their job and will simply drift open to prevent water flowing the wrong way through the lock. There will need to be at least one set of gates pointing in the wrong direction if it is desirable that boats can use the lock. In these circumstances, then there needs to be a full set of gates pointing towards the tidal or river side. The usual method is to have gates pointing in opposite directions at both ends of the chamber. Alternatively, the paired stop lock arrangement of two separate sequential locks pointing in opposite directions would work here, but would require an extra chamber if navigation is not required or impossible at one extreme, e.g. allow navigation above mid-tide, but just prevent the canal emptying at low tide. Then it is only necessary to have one set of bidirectional gates. Two types of bidirectional locks at the end of the Marne-Rhine canal in the independent port of Strasbourg. A sea lock is one that connects a canal or river directly with an estuary or ocean. All sea locks are tidal. Tidal locks. Sea lock at Bude, Cornwall. A tidal lock is generally any lock that connects tidal with non-tidal water. This includes a lock between a tidal river and the non-tidal reaches, or between a tidal river and a canal, or a sea lock. However, the term usually refers specifically to a lock whose method of operation is affected by the state of the tide. Examples: a canal joining a river whose levels are always lower than the canal. All that is needed is an ordinary lock, with the gates pointing up the canal. The lock is used normally so long as the tide is high enough to float boats through the lower gates. If near low tide the lock becomes unusable, then the gates can be barred and simply become a reverse flood gate, holding water in the canal. This arrangement also applies to some sea locks, e.g. Bude Canal. A canal joining a river which is normally below it, but which can rise above it at very high tides, or after heavy rain. One pair of gates can be made bidirectional, i.e. the